just rather ordinary, I think.
Ordinary's good. Yeah. That's what were you like? Were you mischievous? Were you funny?
No, I wasn't anything like that at all. I was very keen on music.
Excellent.
This will probably come to.
Yeah.
And I had a huge advantage in that I was brought up in a Christian home, but it was always made very clear to me that being a Christian was my choice. It was a home totally without coercion, but it was there. So again, I could see how people's decisions, the choices that they made, how they kind of worked out, what it was actually like. And when it didn't work, I got a chance to see that as well.
Yeah, to learn from the mistakes.
Yeah.
So we've got young Nigel in his house. Apparently he's quite normal. What's young Nigel dreaming about? What were your aspirations as a child?
It's a very long time ago, Sam.
Well, I'm testing you now.
Yeah.
Go back there.
I started to learn the piano. And I found that I could somehow do it. So I got very, very interested in that. And one day I went into a record shop, as they used to be called.
Oh, no, they're called that again now.
Oh, yeah, of course you can get...
They're vintage. I mean, you're probably vintage. Enjoy it.
You can buy them now. Vinyl, they call them.
In fact, I think you can buy tapes again as well. I don't think VHS will ever come back. That really was poor, but tapes are back.
I feel a bit younger now. on this vinyl, I heard the great works of Chopin and the great piano writers, and I found that fantastically inspiring, because you've got to remember as well that my parents weren't particularly musical. We didn't have music around the house.
But were supportive of you or not?
And again, they were non-coercive. If you want to do it, fine. I was able to listen. And the very strange thing about it was that I never got bored in church.
That is a miracle.
Very, very unusual.
Yeah. I used to play cars under the pews. I'd take my best toys and disappear and then reappear at the end thinking... I don't know whether anyone else has done this, but I used to count how many verses there were in songs.
I still do that.
Yeah. Oh. And you tell when you go, please, none over the page. Yeah. Oh, there's three over the page.
Yeah,
it's going
on
forever.
Oh, I'm still the same.
Yeah, and you pray for
in
Jesus.
In fact, I make signs. My wife and I make signs, you know.
Six. It's a six-verser. Bring out the sandwiches.
Yes.
There's
nothing new about that.
Yeah.
The thing that really switched things on for me was that I was just old enough. I think it was 1953. I was just old enough to know what was happening out there in the world, and there was a remarkable turning towards Christianity in this country. There was an evangelist who came over from America called Billy Graham.
I know
who's the
Billy.
Stuff of legends.
He
legends
is.
Now.
Yeah.
But the interesting thing about him was that he actually got through to the normal people of this nation that I call Joe Public. You know, not just church people. Somehow he hit the headlines and used to have these enormous rallies. He would fill Wembley Stadium and get on national television and national radio. And that impressed me enormously. And so the first thing that happened to me was when I was aged about seven or something. I remember sitting up in bed, presumably with the cake crumbs everywhere, and listening to Billy Graham. And at the end of the service, he asked if anybody wanted to give their hearts to Jesus. This was a live broadcast from Wembley Stadium. And I decided there and then, sitting up in bed, that I wanted to do that.
How did you have the TV on in your room?
Oh, it wasn't on TV.
It was on the radio.
Yeah.
So you were listening to it.
It was almost before TV.
Let me just clarify. So you're lying in bed eating cake?
Yeah. Well, I presume so, yeah.
Probably. Nice.
Yeah, probably with a can of beer or something.
A light snack before bed, glass of milk, slice of cake. Yeah.
It's the cake crumbs that are the problem. They sort of get
in the... Yeah, nightmare. Same with bread.
Horrible.
In fact, any grainy food. valid. So you're sitting in bed, eating cake.
Yeah.
You're chilled, radio's on, Billy speaking. What happens then?
Well, as I say, this invitation came. Would you like to invite Christ into your heart and into your life? And, you know, you're quite simple when you're 7 or 8. I decided, yes, I wanted to do that. So I followed the prayer through. And there and then I gave my life to Christ. A lot has to happen, of course. When you do that at 7, you don't know, of course, what you're doing fully. Mind you don't when you're 70. I mean, because only God knows.
Yeah.
That's the point of what we're trying to say tonight. Only God knows where we're all going.
But you look back and you say that's where it started for you.
Yeah.
As your personal journey. Yeah.
And there has to be stages. As you get older, you actually realize new things and the effects that it has. And I mean, the next big thing that happened to me was when I decided, when I was 12, I decided, because nobody else was going to decide for me, I wanted to be baptized. And we used to go to one of those churches where, you know, you got properly dunked.
Nice. No light head sprinkling there.
No. You went down into a pool.
Excellent.
And 1, 2, 3, down. You had to hold your breath.
Bring yourself back up again, otherwise...
They let you come up again.
Right, good. You haven't, anyway.
But I liked that, and I still like that. Forgive me, I hope this doesn't offend anybody. But I liked that because there was that sense that the entirety of you was being immersed, and your whole life was being given to Christ, not a bit of it. That it was the kind of totality of it that I really liked.
That you enjoyed.
Yeah.
Excellent.
And I remember, just before you ask the next question, I remember very distinctly in the days and months after that, I had never experienced such happiness. Never, ever. It was an extraordinary thing. That's that.
Wonderful. Mm. Why? Why were you happy?
Well, I don't know.
You just were.
God never took me on one side and explained.
Right.
But I suppose, I don't know, I suppose I'd been immersed into Christ.
So you're just enjoying him.
And it was that, I suppose, I found out why I was here.
Yeah.
Somehow.
Wonderful. So we've got now 12-year-old Nigel. He's been dunked.
Yeah.
He's happy.
Yeah.
He's looking at life. What happened then? Did you start making decisions about your future, deciding on a career path, anything like that? What happened next for you?
Yeah, I went on to school and everything, and I carried on with the piano playing, and I found I could actually do it. And so I began to think about going to study music.
Which is tough. It's a tough gig.
Yeah, and I was... advised heavily against it.
There's no money in it.
No,
I wanted to be an actor, and my parents said the same. They were like, no, there's no money in it.
And then, I mean, I was given the advice that I would give to anybody now. Don't do it.
Yeah, okay.
Quite apart from anything else, you know, you probably won't succeed. Only very few people succeed.
And we're here to encourage you tonight, guys.
Yes.
Live your dreams. No, don't do that.
But, yeah. And I... You know, just to skip on a bit, I am one of the privileged few. I have actually been able to live off music for the bulk of my life, but that's it. That is a rarity. But
yeah,
it's also a great privilege.
Wonderful. Mm. So where did you end up then for your schooling?
In the end, I went. I made the people at my school rather cross, because when I was 17, I did my A-levels a year early, but just before I did them, age 17, I snuck off to London with my mother one afternoon, and I went for an audition at the Royal Academy of Music, and they gave me a place, and my school was not very happy, because it was one of these posh schools where really the ambition was to get everybody somehow into a posh university. and I'd said, blow that for a game of soldiers. I'm going to go off and learn to play the piano.
Wonderful.
So off I did. Still rebellious. That's probably my main characteristic.
But you rebelled into a top musical academy. Which is a good rebellion.
I don't know. Not everybody thought it was. So, I was very pleased.
You're at the Royal Academy of Music. You're surrounded probably by lots of other people, suddenly a lot more like yourself than maybe you'd experienced. But what was it like studying there and being there and being surrounded by other people who were brilliant at their instruments?
Well, it was extraordinary, really. It was only when I got there that I actually realised I didn't know anything about music anyway. I was a country bumpkin, really, coming from Tetbury in Gloucestershire. My parents didn't know anything about music, and I'd hardly heard any music. All I knew was that I could actually play the piano, and I enjoyed doing that. But when I got there, I was surrounded by people who knew all this music that I'd never heard of. And I wasn't actually particularly interested in... It took me some years before I ever did become. But I made some good friends there, and I had a lot of fun.
And so you're studying. What were you thinking in terms of life? What were your hopes and dreams in terms of the piano?
Well, you always hope, when you go into that, in perhaps a rather deluded way, you actually hope that one day you'll be able to earn your living by playing the piano. It's probably the same if you go into sport, actually. You know, you hope to play for England, don't you? I hoped I'd be able to do that.
So you're pinning everything.
And I was making good progress. I made some quite good progress.
Yeah. And you're pinning everything on the piano playing then at this point.
Yeah.
It's a big deal.
Yes, it was.
And so you got some bad news while you were there. Was it afterwards? I'm not sure. Tell us a little about what happened out of sort of... You're wanting to go and play piano for your life, for your money.
Yeah.
Something happened. Tell us about that.
About halfway through this course, I was doing very well. And quite suddenly, I started not being able to do certain things with my right hand. And that got worse and worse. So my right hand just wouldn't function in the way it needed to. And that, of course, was a catastrophe. I could go plonk, plonk, plonk still, but I couldn't do the clever stuff.
Yeah. And what was going through your mind at that point?
Well, the one bit of common sense that I had gleaned was to make sure that I got a qualification which qualified me to be a teacher. As the old saying is, you know, he who can does, he who cannot teaches. So fortunately, I was taking that, and I managed to just scrape through this, because you needed to be able to play the piano. Mm. But I managed to do that. And what it meant was that I could, you know, earn enough money for beer and fags anyway.
So, beer, fags, but a shattered future.
Yeah.
What did you do then? What did you do?
Yeah. Well, I did go into teaching, I found actually that I could do it. I didn't really enjoy it, but I could do it. So I went through a number of different institutions. I started off at what they used to call secondary modern schools. It was where you got to if you didn't get into the grammar schools. And then I moved up and went to be head of department in a grammar school. And then I went to be head of department in comprehensives, which had then come in. And I've wound up here at Salford, what's now Salford University. Being head of composition there. I was very fortunate. The only snag was I didn't particularly enjoy it.
Okay, so you moved out then of piano playing and sort of started to see music very differently. Tell us about that. What changed for you, and why did you start seeing music differently?
Well, I think of course, my Christian life was developing all through that.
Yeah.
And I came to actually suddenly realize how powerful music could be in the hands of God. And this, you have to remember, was at the time of what we call the charismatic movement in this country. I don't know whether that term means anything to you folks these days, but it was a revival that we had in this country, which was inside the church. It wasn't outside the church, but it was inside, where people learned about the supernatural gifts of the Holy Spirit, things like healing, the ability to heal. I had lots of remarkable experiences getting into that. One of the many illnesses that I've had is, as a late teenager, getting lots of pain in the bottom of my back, and eventually going to the doctor, and he said, "Oh, you've got a thing called ankylosing spondylitis. That's a kind of rheumatic thing in your sacroiliac joints." And he said, "By the way, it's not curable." And he said, "You know, you've seen those people going around who are all bent double." He said, "They've probably got that, and that's what you've got." Thankfully, I didn't deteriorate that quickly. But to cut a long story short, I got involved in some music in Birmingham, which was Holy Spirit type of music. And one day, a lady just rang me out of the blue, and she said, "Oh, the Lord's told me you're healed." I said, "What?" "Well," she said, "that's all I can say. You've been healed." And the next time I went for x-rays, the doctor said to me, "Well, how are you getting on?" I said, "Well, I'm all right, apart from the fact that I've got ankylosing spondylitis. And if you look at my x-ray, you'll see it there." He said, "I'm looking at your x-ray. There's nothing there." So those sorts of things were beginning to happen.
What did you make of that at the time?
Well, in a funny sort of way, in those days, we were half expecting it.
Okay. What did the doctor's face look like?
I can't remember. I just can't remember. They have a way. They always have a way of explaining these things. Mixed in with that, there were all these interesting things happening in the church. But mixed in with that was the astonishing power of music, which I'd never encountered before. I remember once going to a worship evening in Worcester Cathedral, and I was standing behind a pillar, and there was a girl who stood up with a guitar. I couldn't even see who it was, and she started singing, and the power of this hit me in a way that I'd never been hit by a piece of music ever before. It was fantastically simple. And what we were learning in those days was when the Holy Spirit comes and gets hold of a gift that you might have, the power of the gift is enhanced beyond all recognition. That's kind of God in your life. And I was watching this. I was completely awestruck.
Wonderful. And did you then go on to experience some of this in your own life? And if you did, how did it work itself out?
Yeah, I mean, cutting long stories short here. And in a way, this is the point I'm hoping that you'll pick up if you're interested in this at all. What I found was that I suddenly had a gift for conducting, you see, which I never realised I had. I was only interested in playing the piano. I didn't want to know about anything else.
Can I ask?
Yeah.
I'm not cynical of conducting.
Yeah.
It just looks like anyone can do it.
Yes, exactly.
Do you know what I mean?
Yeah.
I've got it. I've nailed it.
Yeah.
Have I? Or is there a little bit more
There's a bit more to it than that, yeah. Although they do call it...
Educate my ignorance.
Musicians call conducting the silent mistake. That is very cynical.
Yeah.
But, you know, if you make a mistake on a French horn, everybody hears it. If a conductor makes a mistake, it's silent. Nobody knows he's made a mistake.
It's true.
Except everybody in front of him. But, conducting is... it's the ability to form a liaison, an agreement... with a company of people. I can be, if we play some of these little snippets in a minute, you'll be able to see, you know, I might be standing in front of 100 people, and it's somehow having the ability to form an agreement with all 100 of them, to suspend perhaps their own musical judgments, because they'll have all kinds of judgments which won't be like yours. But to get them to agree to suspend their judgment and to look at a piece of music your way, and not many people can actually do that. As you say, it looks easy, but it's behind you've actually got to be able to cause people to agree to go together with you and to look at something from your perspective. And I found I could do that, and I found that people were affected by that. People in the audiences were affected, and in very, very remarkable ways. I think we're probably getting to the stage now where I could show you one or two clips.
So we've got we have got some clips of Nigel conducting,
yeah,
and some of the responses of people who are affected by what you were doing. So this is the outworking of Nigel's story of experiencing the Holy Spirit, your shattering, sort of not being able to play the piano for a living, but God sort of turning that on its head and saying and giving you a new direction. And this is the outworking of that.
Yeah.
So should we have a watch?
Let's have a watch.
Yeah.
I think what just one thing before we start. What I found he was doing, God, in it, he was taking my musical gifts and my musical perceptions, which I had channeled exclusively into piano playing. He was taking that same stuff, that same musicianship, and he was saying, no, we're going to express it on a much wider scale, in fellowship with lots and lots of other musicians and reaching people from all over the world. Whereas if you just stuck in that little narrow tunnel, you would only have affected, even if you'd been very successful, you would have only affected the smallest fraction of people.
Mm.
And that's my, just before we do watch it, that's the point. If you pick up anything, friends, that I want to say to you, only God really knows you. Only God knows me. And he knows our potential. And the point is that our potential is 1,000 times greater than ever we imagine. And what his purpose is for us all is to release our potential, but if you know, only he knows what it is. So I'm going to ask Harvey to play these in just one tick. What I would like you to look at in all of these are the audiences. Don't bother looking at me or the singers or the players. Incidentally, you might find one or two people here you recognize, but don't look at the performers. Look at the audiences. Look at the vast numbers of people who are being affected. And I can just tell you that there, among these people, there are 87 different nations, nationalities, people who've come into the Pantheon in Rome and are watching what we're doing. We must. Well, why don't we have a look, Harvey? Could you? Let's have the Hallelujah chorus.
English Orchestra, with artistic director and conductor Nigel Swinford, performing at the Pantheon in Rome.
So now we've got some individual reactions. So have a listen to this, friends. Oh, in a minute. Yeah,
there's
just watch this.
From the thousands of tourists who come and go from the Pantheon every day. Official announcements struggle to maintain the atmosphere of a church. But in contrast, one young woman has almost single-handedly converted this bustling collection of camera-clicking iPad-panning tourists into a silent, still congregation.
So now have a listen to this. Sorry, could you go to the next one?
It's much easier for them to.
So is it possible to jump to the next track? Now we've got a bit coming up now, and I'd like you to look. We do a processional, as you'll see, and have a look at the expression on people's faces as we go out. I like, in particular, looking at the men. You can just see that they're. Some of them are almost startled by what they're looking at, and are actually fighting to keep back the tears. It's particularly fascinating. So have a look at the personal reactions here. It's the one before. It's the track before this. It's the continuation after that, those two blokes. You were looking at Salzburg then, by the way. That's another story.
It's touched my soul.
Chuck, I should let that run.
It's amazing. I can't describe it because it was. I don't know how to say anything, but it is in their part.
We let it run.
My quest in making this film was to find out why these NEO people do what they do and what effect they have. I think I've discovered the answer. I wonder if you agree. Having experienced this recreatio or recreation concert, it's clear that these people come together to do what they love doing, making music. But what makes the New English Orchestra different is that they love to make music for and about Jesus. And in the making, something amazing and mysterious happens.
So have a look at the faces, folks.
Ironically, in bringing their various talents of singing, playing, and enabling, the whole team become instruments themselves. It is via their music, words, and stillness that people catch a glimpse of the God who offers peace, healing, and new life in Jesus. Through the New English Orchestra, God sends out his invitation to the world.
So, friends, I think I've probably said enough, really, but you could see from the reactions, and I realized after a while that actually any musician, whether their name is Joe Bloggs or Ludwig van Beethoven, would be quite happy with those reactions. I mean, if you go to a Beethoven concert in Bridgewater Hall or something, people will come out joyful. They'll come out saying, that was fantastic, that was great. But if you were a composer and you got those reactions, you would think, yeah, that's what I want. That's the effect I'd like my music to have.
Wonderful. Wonderful. I need to ask, as we're talking about story, yours still has more chapters to write. Do you have anything in mind for the future? What are you writing into your story now?
As you've already learned, I'm not young. And it's particularly difficult, you know, when you get to my age, which if you're lucky, you will. the tricky thing is, right, now, will I be dead in 2 years? Or will I be like my mother, who carries on till she's nearly 100. Have I got 30 years to go, or 3? And it's extraordinarily difficult to make plans under those circumstances. Extraordinarily difficult. But I've got some things that I'd like to do. I'm still tinkering away. I do little bits of work for BBC still. I've done a lot. I could have shown you loads of stuff that I've done for BBC. But I've got some things that I'm planning to do. I've been invited to do.
Wonderful.
Creative things. So I'm hoping that they might grow, but they won't be on this scale because I don't have the physical energy to do that anymore.
Of course. Well, Nigel, I want to thank you for letting me sit here and sort of listen to your story. I think we all appreciated that. It's always amazing to hear someone of a different generation, and we just get to sit and glean and listen to your story, and it was a real privilege. So will you just join me in thanking Nigel very much for sharing his story with us this evening? Thank you. Thank you very much, Nigel. That was really wonderful. Thank you.